Good evening, everyone. Thanks for being with us today. Before we begin, I would like to thank Priyanshi. So, Priyanshi, thank you for taking out the time to share your experience with our students. I'm sure they will gain a lot from your insights and your journey. Our second panelist today is Vishal. So, he is one of our senior most quant faculty. So, Vishal, again, thanks for taking out the time, and I'm sure our students will be able to gain a lot of insights from you as well. Let's hope that we have a very interactive and great webinar. Before we proceed, some ground rules for everyone. How many of you are Jamboree students? So if you are a Jamboree student, can you raise your hands? So all Jamboree students, please raise your hands. Okay. So we have got quite a few Jamboree students. So that's always good. So those of you who are not Jamboree students, a very brief introduction about Jamboree. Don't want to take too much of your time. So Jamboree, we train for exams such as GMAT, GRE, SAT. So we don't do CAT or any other exams. We are specialists in that sense that we only focus on a handful of exams, and we believe in delivering great results in those exams. We also do extensive admissions counseling. We advise students about which colleges they should be applying to. Then we help them out with their application process, etc. We have been around since 1993, so that's a long time. I'm sure more than half of you weren't even born in that time. So it's a long time ago. And we are the first of its kind of company. After us, a couple of more companies came up who focus purely on these exams. We have offices in 39 physical locations in 22 cities and 4 countries. We also have very strong online presence. So the courses, our GMAT, GRE, SAT. So we train them through online media as well, digital learning. So we started teaching virtually 5 years ago. And that was extremely useful for us. When the whole lockdown thing happened, we could seamlessly transition to online learning. So our experience in the digital learning space have kind of helped us tide through these tough times. We had many students now in the last two and a half months who have joined purely in the online mode and have been continuing with their classes. So that's all about us. So we are going to be together for the next 1 hour at least. And during that time, if you have any other questions about Jamboree, we'll be more than happy to address those. Some ground rules. While we are speaking, please do not type your questions in the chat window. We will have a dedicated Q&A session at the end. So please hold on to your questions. If you keep on typing your questions in your chat window, we will not be able to address those, right? So hold on to your questions. I will also deactivate the chat after some time, but I just thought it is polite to let you know that I'm going to do that. So let's hear from Priyanshi first, and then we can ask our questions. So Priyanshi, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Where did you do your bachelor's degree? When did you take your GMAT exam, etc.? Or whatever else you want to share with us about yourself.
Right. So as this poster says, my name is Priyanshi Sharma. I am studying economics honors at Daulat Ram College. I took the GMAT in August last year. I got through ISB's YLP in October last year. That is when I applied when I was in my pre-final year, and right now I'm in my final year. So I think that's a little bit about my educational background and what I'm currently doing.
Okay. So so when did you decide that you want to do an MBA?
So I did not specifically decide that I wanted to do an MBA till I think first or second year in college. Before that, I knew that I wanted to get into business and probably do something in the business management area, but I did not know about the exact pathway that I should take. And in my first year, I got to know about ISB's YLB, which is what drove me towards taking the GMAT and eventually applying for the program. And that's about it, I think.
A lot of students like yourself, you know, when they are in college, etc. So I hear, actually, the data says that most of them do end up taking the CAT, but you didn't seem to go down that path. Why not?
That's interestingly also a question that I was asked in my ISB interview. I never thought of taking the CAT because we often had these CAT seminars in college, and that actually demotivated me to take the CAT exam because it's the quantitative section on CAT, I think, is something that is not manageable for me and something that I would not want to invest so much time on, because when I compared the two exams, the verbal section for GMAT and CAT both were pretty manageable. But for the quant section, I thought that CAT's quant is too technical and something that I would not be really interested in. And second thing, I wanted to go for ISB as against IIMs because it's a little more global perspective and a global MBA school, which is why I wanted to go for it and which is why I took the GMAT as against the CAT. Another reason for that.
Can you elaborate a bit more about when you say global, etc.? So, because this is a question that a lot of people today would want to know, a lot of the attendees would want to know that what were the parameters based on which you decided to go with an ISB MBA rather than the IIM MBA, which in India is like definitely supposed to be one of the most prestigious MBA degrees, right?
Right. So, one more thing that's I think is extremely integral when it comes to a business, a master's in business administration program, that is networking. And a lot of people go for an MBA because they want to form networks in the industry they're interested in and because they want to establish themselves in the industry, right? So when I think about IIMs, I think that the majority of the students come from I would say like a few months of work experience if we take an optimistic view. And a lot of people join straight after college. But for ISB, it's different. All the students there have some amount of work experience, which is why if I would study in a class that consists of people who have, let's say, 4 or 5 years of work experience, it'll be extremely enriching to learn from them, to network with them, to form such contacts. And these will help me establish myself in the industry that I eventually want to be established in, as against an IIM, which has majorly fresh graduates who would have the same amount of experience as me. And I think there would not be as much to learn from them as much as there would be from my classmates at ISB.
Can you elaborate a little bit about what this ISB's YLP program is, you know, how it is different or similar to the regular MBA that is offered by ISB?
Right. So ISB's YLP is also like one of the deferred MBA programs that I think a lot of international universities are also offering now. So if we think of applying to an MBA program regularly, then we need certain amount of work experience. And for a majority of the top universities, I think it's around 4 to 5 years on average. Now, ISB's YLP is a program for which you can apply when you're in your pre-final year or your final year of undergraduate degree or your master's degree, but there should not be your master's degree straight after your undergraduate degree and you're in your pre-final year or final year, then you can apply for ISB's Young Leaders Program. Now, why this is beneficial or why this attracted me was because, again, the major point here is certainty. So while I will be entering the job market after the COVID pandemic ends, I would have a sure seat at one of the top business schools of India, and I would be able to explore more. I would have more freedom to explore as many job profiles and explore as many industries in these two areas, in these 2 years, without worrying about what I'm going to do next, or should I make a profile that is suited for an MBA for a business school, which is why it gives a good amount of certainty, and which entails again freedom to explore various job professions, which is what attracted me. And again, if I try to explain the format a little bit more, so in your pre-final year or final year, you apply, then you have 3 rounds of admission, post which, if you get selected, you have to complete 20 months of work experience before joining the ISB class. So right now, if I will complete my graduation in July, most probably, and post which I will work for 20 months, and then I will join the ISB MBA class starting 2022, hopefully.
Right. So this work experience that you are supposed to do before you start the MBA, so does ISB expect a certain type of company or a certain type of work experience?
No, I don't think they do. They have these regular training weekends and learning weekends. They have them thrice a year, out of which you're expected to attend at least 2. And that's their way to give you constant guidance and mentorship as to your career path. But they do not explicitly state that these are the kind of industries or job profiles we would want you to be working with. So this again brings me back to the point that I made in the last answer, that this is why it enables you to explore and do practically anything you want to, because there is no specific job profile or job industry that's specified, and you can do, but it just has to be full-time work experience of 20 months. So that's the only requirement they have. As of now, they've not contacted me asking me which full-time job offers I have, so I think they're not specific about that. And yeah, I think that's an added advantage to this entire program, that you can practically do any job that you want.
What other programs did you consider?
So before I got through ISB's YLP, I was considering MIM programs abroad. I was considering MIM programs at London School of Business, HEC Paris. Yes, I think just these two. But then I got through ISB, so I do not apply for those programs, because I thought that for me, if I'm getting an MBA degree in a good institution, I would weigh more against an MIM degree. So that is just entirely for me, and that is what made more sense to me, which is why I dropped all those plans and then finalized the ISB YLP admit.
So based on your research of the curriculum, you know, how do you think an MIM curriculum differs from the YLP curriculum? Based on whatever you research, obviously.
My research would be extremely limited in this area, especially about the curriculum. I do know about the, let's say, the eligibility requirements or things like that, but the curriculum I have genuinely not compared. But I think, as much as I've read, an MIM degree is for students who have 0 to 3 years of work experience, and it's majorly offered by universities in the United Kingdom. That's according to my knowledge. And for MBA, you do require, let's say, 3 to 4 years of work experience. And that's one major difference, that you can get through an MIM degree straight out of college. You do not require work experience. But for MBAs, you usually have an explicit requirement of work experience. And that, again, is to start for young, MIM, again, is for young graduates to start their career. But MBA is for certain experienced professionals to accelerate or to transform their career.
Right. So once you decided that you wanted to give YLP a shot, you know, can you for the audience today, can you elaborate a little bit about the stages of the YLP admission process?
Yes, of course. So there are three stages. The first stage, the deadline was around August last year, I think. March, yeah. The first stage starts around March. It's by the end of the March. That's the deadline. The first stage is basic personal information, your awards, your hobbies, your extracurricular activities. Then there's an essay. I mean, this is as per last year's application. I'm not sure how the process has changed or how the requirements have changed. But there was an essay that had no specific topic, but that just said that anything else you would like us to know about your candidacy. The question was around these lines. That was a 300 words essay. And then there was just personal information, hobbies, and all of these things, and awards and recognitions. Then for stage two, after qualifying stage one, for stage two, there was a requirement for the GMAT, one letter of recommendation. Letter of recommendation, not as in you upload a letter of recommendation, but how all business schools operate with letters of recommendation, that you add the details of a recommender and an email is sent to that recommender and they fill out certain questions regarding your candidacy and they directly submit it to ISB. So GMAT recommendation, then there's an essay. Again, it was a 300 word essay and the topic was something around the lines of unlearning certain things is essential to learn new things. That was the essay topic for my application process, 300 words again. And yeah, I think these were the three major requirements in stage two, along with your personal details and your extracurricular activities, your CV, of course, that again plays a major role in stage two. Post which, if you qualify that too, then stage three is the interview process. Interviews I'm from Delhi, so my interview was conducted in Delhi. I think they conduct interviews in various cities, from which they get a major amount of applications, which is why I think they conduct it in Delhi. And the interview process, my interview lasted for 10 to 15 minutes, I think. And post which, after a month of the interview, the results were out and I was admitted.
So 15 minutes was quite short. You know, I have never heard of such a short interview. They have already made up your mind before the interview, or you may have dazzled them at the interview round, because 15 minutes is quite a short interview.
I would like to believe both. But I think that's what they, even in the email that they sent, they said that the interview will last for 15 minutes. But when I went there, I saw that a lot of panelists are spending more time than that. And a lot of people who are coming out of their interview said that their interviews lasted for 30 minutes, 45 minutes. So I'm sure that that is the case for the majority, but mine just lasted for 15 minutes. And I think that is an exception based on the other people who were there in the room, because they came out after 30 minutes, 45 minutes, and some even after an hour.
That's our experience too, that on an average 30 minutes. So 15 minutes is, I mean, I have heard of 10, 15 minutes interviews, but those were usually for rejected candidates. You know, admitted candidates, 15 minutes interview is like, you know, it's quite an exception. So can you tell us a little bit about your profile in terms of your academics? How would you rate yourself as a student? I mean, if you're comfortable, then, you know, if you can share your rank in your class, et cetera, academics wise, where do you put yourself?
Right. So I wouldn't specifically rate myself. I can share my credentials and I would leave it up to you to judge. So I have, I had an 8.18 GPA in my first year and 8.07 GPA in my second year. So the aggregate came to about 8.125. The third year GPA is not out yet. We still have to take our exams. So 8.125 was my aggregate GPA in economics honors at Delhi University. So that's my academics. My GMAT score, I think, you know, was 720. If I tell you the breakup, it was 40 on verbal and 48 on quant. So as I said, my verbal was still a strong point, but quant, I would consider it not a good aspect of my application. And I think 48 would be something that is lower than the average Indian application pool. So if you can work on that, I think it would be great, because 50 and 51 usually Indian people get in the quantitative section of GMAT. Then for my extracurricular activities, I think the major extracurricular activity that I practice in college is debating. And if I talk about positions of responsibility, I was the president of my college's debating society for the session 2019-20. I was the secretary general of my college's Model United Nations Conference session, Model United Nations Conference for the year 2019, secretary general for my college's Indian Youth Parliament. Then this year I was the chief advisor of my college's MUN, but this was not counted in my CV last year because this happened this year. I would just talk about the things that were counted in my ISB application. So that was president of the debating society, secretary general, college MUN. Then I was a core team member of the Leaders for Tomorrow Foundation of my college. I think some of the Delhi University students would know about this, but it's I would still elaborate that it's a nationwide leadership initiative that it's that is aimed at awakening the social consciousness of youth. Then I was also one of the founding members of my college's English parliamentary debate that also happened last year. I think, yeah, that's about my extracurricular activities. So it's majorly debating and public speaking and Model United Nations conferences. I have quite a few awards in university and national level debates and Model United Nations conferences. So I think this covers for most of my extracurricular activities.
Also, I think, you know, based on whatever we've been speaking for 15 minutes now, I also think that you are extremely articulate. So that might have also probably come across, you know, in the interview.
In the interview, I think that is why it lasted for 15 minutes. They got what they wanted.
right. So you, in addition to your debates and like the MUNs, et cetera, any kind of hobbies, et cetera?
Hobbies. I remember there was a hobby section in the stage one application, and I was recently going through it, and I read that I had added three hobbies. One was gardening, which I enjoyed earlier, but I these days I've not been able to practice that. So that was one hobby. Then listening to music and playing the guitar, that's also something that I did, and I don't play the guitar anymore. And then another hobby was traveling. Of course, I've been to various countries across the globe and various cities in India, and traveling, adventure sports, and trekking trips. These are the activities that I enjoy the most, and this is what I wrote about also in the stage one application. So yeah, these were my hobbies, I think. Gardening, listening to music, the guitar, and traveling, trekking, adventure sports. Yeah, I think that was it. And also photography. That is a hobby, but that I did not include in my stage one application because you could only add three hobbies. But this is just additional information about me.
No, I think that presents a very well-rounded and well-rounded application. Your academics, your whole debating thing, all of that, you know, presents you as a very sincere, hardworking, diligent kind of student. And then with the guitar and the adventure sports, it just adds, you know, different facets to your personality. Yeah, I mean, it's you are not just a good student. You are also like, you know, you are into adventure sports. You have a creative side, as indicated by your ability to learn, let's say, guitar, or maybe you're in inclination towards music. So I think the well-rounded application is good. Plus the 720 GMAT for our female candidate is also strong, actually. I mean, those the attendees who, so it's not just flat when you hear data that for ISB you have to have a 700 GMAT. So it's not that kind of a thing. You know, it varies, you know, who you are, what kind of background you are from, what kind of academics you are into. Plus, I think Vishal will kind of back me up on that, with your female candidates, The you know, if a male candidate with exactly the same profile would need a 750 to get an admit, a female candidate with a 700, 710. We have had cases with students with 660, 680 have also got admitted into ISB. So because they want to have a diverse classroom. So that is one area where, and data says that in India, number of GMAT test takers who are female is far lower than males. So everything put together. So there are a lot of factors that come into play. So Vishal, you have been training students on the GMAT for quite some time. So where do you think Indian students usually make a mistake when starting out with their GMAT prep?
So there are multiple points that are coming to my mind, but if you look at Indian students, and there are multiple people asking about the preparation journey for Priyanshi, I believe there's always a good thought process behind why to take CAT or GMAT. So Priyanshi, in your case, you have highlighted that quants was the main reason that you shifted to GMAT, but we also come across many students who say that the kind of flexibility GMAT exam provides you, that's something leads to, migration or shift towards GMAT exam.
Right.
But can you brief us about your preparation journey? Because I'm sure you in last year and many of our attendees must be interested in knowing what are the key parameters that you actually maybe evaluated before joining Jamboree for your preparation journey. So what were those factors? Why did you join Jamboree? And then we will come to your basically GMAT preparation.
One thing that I'd like to add here, that when I said that I chose GMAT over CAT, one factor was, of course, the quantitative abilities test, but another was that I did not want to go to an IIM. So just adding that again. But yes, coming to my GMAT preparation, I started in January last year. I heard about GMAT from a friend. He had been a student since a week, and he was telling me about the classes and about how the syllabus, or about what all the GMAT tests and how his experience till now has been. And I knew that I wanted to do this. I wanted to eventually take the GMAT, and I thought that this would be a right time to take it because I'm in the habit of studying. And if I graduate and then take it and then probably apply for an MBA after 4 or 5 years, then I would not be habitual to studying, and it would be a little more difficult for me to do that then. Which is why I went to the Jamboree Center in Hudson Lane, which is closest to my college. And I talked to a few people there, and they told me about the courses and about what all Jamboree provides. So there were regular classes, of course. Then there was access to the Jamboree dashboard and Jamboree's GMAT preparation tests, which I think are 15, 20 of them. And I took all of them, just by the way. And then the resources provided by Jamboree in terms of the books, the official guide, the red books and the blue books, I think they're extremely helpful. I will again start in the...
So I have a counter question here. Basically, if we talk about only the preparation period from the day you attended the first class and till the day you have taken your GMAT exam, how much time you invested in attending the classroom sessions, then how much time you invested in taking mock tests? So can you brief all the attendees about this thing?
Yeah, okay. I was just coming to that. I have a habit of diverting very frequently, so this would be good. I joined in January, mid-January, I think, if I'm not wrong. Then I had I was enrolled in the weekend batch, and I had two classes every weekend, one for verbal and one for quant. I finished those classes by... I'm not sure when, but I got done with all the classes for the weekend batch. And then I had my exams in the month of May, my college exams in the month of May, which is why I completely cut off on GMAT for April and May, both months, I completely cut off on GMAT. I was not studying at all. I was not doing the homework, nothing. Which is why after May, when my exams got over and I opened the books again, I was completely lost. And I did not know, I thought that I needed some amount of flexibility and some amount of refresher to get back to GMAT preparation, which is why I joined the weekday batch again. And I think that's a great amount of flexibility that Jamboree gives you, that if you enroll once, you can take the classes for the entire year, which is what I utilize to the max. So I enrolled again in June for the weekday batch. Then I had 4 classes every week. And at that time, the end semester break was going on, so I did not have college. So I thought that I will completely dedicate all my time to this. So I started the classes in June. The classes got over by the first week of July, I think. And then I took my first attempt on 8th August. But then that did not pan out well. So then I took another attempt on August 25. So if you talk about my entire journey of taking the GMAT, then I would not count the period from Jamboree, because I had been extremely irresponsible during that period. I was not doing the homework. I was practically not doing anything. And during the exams, I completely cut off. So I would say my intensive and dedicated GMAT practice started from June, and I took the exam in August.
All right. So based on your experience, what are the common pitfalls in the GMAT preparation, and how can our attendees actually avoid those pitfalls in order to do really well in their first attempt? Any learnings that you have?
So I think for this question, comparing my first attempt and my second attempt would be a good place to start with, because if when I compare them, I think about the things that I did differently in my second attempt, which is what got me a higher score. So when I took my first attempt, I took it on 8th August, as I said. I booked the second test on the same date, and it was for 25th August. So during that time, I only and exclusively did practice tests. I had done practice tests before. I had taken the GMAT prep 1, official prep 1 and 2, and prep 5 and 6, and I had also taken Jamboree's mock test, the full length mock test. These I had taken before my first attempt, but after my first attempt, I thought that I needed more practice of sitting in front of a computer screen and having an active mind that's constantly working and constantly thinking, constantly capable of thinking about questions. So then during those 16 or 17 days, I took 2 tests every day. I think I took 1 test every day, but on some days I took 2 tests. And then I would analyze every question that I got wrong. And even in those 16 days, I also analyzed the papers that I had attempted before my first attempt. And I analyzed all of those questions and established a pattern. And I think if you're doing wrong, let's say in verbal repeatedly, and you're not getting a good score, there most definitely is a pattern. So you need to, this is what I would suggest, that if you're trying to get a better score and you're not able to get that, you should analyze your wrong questions and try to understand which specific topics you're getting wrong questions in. So let's say it's parallelism in verbal, or let's say it's algebra in quantitative. So this is what helped me. I established a pattern. And when I did that, I acknowledged that these are the things that I am always getting wrong answers for. Then the next time I would get a similar question which tested similar skills, I would be careful, I would be more careful, and I would be more attentive, and I would not make those same mistakes again. So I think major takeaway from this entire answer is that acknowledge your mistakes and establish a pattern of your mistakes, so that those same mistakes at least don't happen again. If you make mistakes and don't get a score, it's because you made new mistakes, but at least you should not make the same mistakes that you made in your prep. So I think not just taking tests, but also analyzing each test and learning something out of each test is important. Just taking tests blindly and not following what you've been doing wrong, I think that's a little aimless, and that won't result in a lot of a hike in your GMAT score.
Right. So Priyanshi, I have also interacted with more than 1,000 students as part of my experience with Jamboree. What I have observed is students who especially who are in the pre-final or final year of their graduation, their academic ability to understand, interpret, and process information is far better than a person who is 5 years experienced. So these students are bound to do well in any of the competitive exam. But as you rightly mentioned, they are always in a hurry because till that point of time in their schools, in their colleges, they have prepared for a subject and have taken the test and they have done well in those tests. So they are in a hurry to take the exam. And in your case also, as you mentioned in the first attempt, it was just after few days, few weeks, you are done with the classes and you have taken the exam. So there's definite some amount of time is required. And during that time, this is the value added point that you mentioned. It is very, very important to analyze your mistake and to improve on that. Right. And what sort of support was provided during this period? Because till first attempt, till the time you were coming in the to the classroom sessions, you were linked to Jamboree faculty members, operation team and all. Right. But once you have taken the first attempt, you were no more coming for the regular classes. What sort of support was provided by Jamboree during that period?
So during that period, I would have to say that I completely I went back to the Jamboree Center once after my first attempt to talk to the teachers. And that's when my verbal teacher recommended that I should take more tests. And I discussed this with her that should I take more tests or what should I do? So she said that your preparation is you've done everything, you've done all content that you had to. And I think what Jamboree's approach is and what I specifically liked about Jamboree is that they preach that it's not necessary for you to read all the books available on GMAT. You don't have to read the official guide and Manhattan Prep, Veritas Prep and everything. So it's a very streamlined process that, okay, this is the content that's going to be tested. This is the content that you have to do. And since I was done with that already till my first attempt, my teacher recommended that you've done all the content that you had to do. So there's no need to read more books or get more content. You just need practice of taking the exam and analyzing where you're going wrong, because you know the concepts, you know everything, you just need to acknowledge where you're going wrong and get your body and mind more habitual to taking a 4-hour long test, which is what directed me towards taking more tests. And again, the mistakes pattern, establishing the mistakes pattern. So I think that's a good point about, that's an advantage about GMAT. I've honestly not tested other GMAT centers, but this is, I think, something that is really beneficial, that teachers usually recommend that, okay, you study this book and that book and study all possible books, but they really have a streamlined process and just tell you about the concepts and the skills that they're testing and ask you to specifically focus on that and then getting your mind accustomed to taking the test. And I think that is the approach that should be followed for taking the GMAT or for any exam for that matter.
Right. Extending to this point, I think I would like to take this opportunity to share it with all the attendees that whenever students come to us, many times they have this thought in mind that more the material, better is the result. So yeah, rather than going for maybe material of two institutes once time, it's better to do a single material twice, but do it thoroughly. Right?
Yeah, so I think even the official guide has all the concepts and all the basic things that you need to get. So if you do that once, this is what my verbal teacher, Megha ma'am, she used to constantly tell us that if you do the official guide thoroughly, there is no need for you to do there is no need for you to do tens of tests and read so many books. So if we just imbibe the official guide and thoroughly get done with it, then we're really clear on our concepts, both on verbal and for quant. And even the workshops that were held every Friday, I think that they were also taken by Megha ma'am. They were extremely beneficial. She picked out specific questions out of the blue book, which is considered a little, which consists of a questions that are a little higher than that are a little difficult than the average. So she would pick out questions from the blue book and discuss those questions thoroughly, and we would really be able to analyze with her personally our problems and our difficulties with approaching higher level questions. So I think the workshops also helped a lot.
Right. So according to your understanding, how much time a typical graduate student has to give for the GMAT preparation on a daily basis during the preparation time?
On a daily basis, I would say if you're taking the classes, so the classes last for two and a half, three hours, I think. 3 hours, yeah. So after that, I think as much time as it takes you to complete the homework. That's the recommended time from my side, because I won't say that spend 30 minutes or 40 minutes, because it's very subjective as to the amount of time that each person takes to solve, let's say, 10 or 15 questions. So I think as much time as it takes for you to complete homework fully and completely understand it, that is the time you should spend on the GMAT preparation while you're taking your classes. And another thing that I would like to add here, that like, since you had, let's say you had a class today and you have a class tomorrow. So while you're doing tomorrow's homework, while you're doing the homework tomorrow, you should analyze yesterday's class and see what mistakes you got there, and try to understand those well in time so that you don't have to struggle afterwards to find out your mistakes and establish a pattern. So I think doing your homework regularly is extremely important, because then when you go to the class, you are aware of what your answers were and how you came to your answers, and how the teacher is coming to his or her answers, and what's their approach. So I think that, and after the classes are over, I'd say taking one or two tests every day. So I think one test takes 4 hours. So that entirely depends on your capacity. I'm somebody who cannot sit at one place for very long. So I could, for most days, only I did two tests on days per day, and those some days are very few days, like 3-4 days at the most. But yeah, it depends on your capacity. And after you finish with your classes, you should definitely take at least one GMAT prep in one go, without taking breaks and sitting in an isolated environment, so that you replicate the process that will actually happen with you while you're taking the official GMAT test. So I'd recommend taking one test every day, and if you have more capacity, taking two tests per day would also not hurt.
All right. And I think Ozma will also agree with me that during the last few years, we are seeing increase in the interest in the programs like YLP. Because the moment you, these days students are very well aware, and they don't want to go to a traditional job. They want to try different things. The moment you already have admit from institutes like ISB, the day you go to your job, you are very clear what are you going for. You are not going there to make a career out of it. You are going to gain experience. And when the focus is on experience, because you already have the backup option available, I think you can do wonders, right?
Yeah.
So the flexibility this program provides, I think that makes it very unique. You already have clarity, and good thing is the engagement part of it, like 2-weekend mandatory training at ISB. So that's something that keeps you linked to ISB. It's not like you have been given an offer and you will be joining after a few years, right? So that link, that alumni network from that day you got selected, I think that's the biggest advantage of this ISB YLP program.
Yeah, for sure.
Ozma, do you have any thoughts on this, with the flexibility?
Yeah, I think definitely, and I mean, totally agree that, now you can, that you are going for an MBA program 2 years later. So, you can actually invest. People are usually more focus in during those 20 months of work experience, because they know that, okay, I have to learn this, I have to learn that. These are the skills that I should pick up at work so that I can gain more from my MBA. Vice versa, somebody, who is just starting out a job. So 6 months, the person is usually lost trying to find out whether he or she likes the job or not like the job. So I have always found that YLP, people who have gotten into the YLP program, so they end up benefiting far more from their first few years of work experience, than rank, freshers.
So, and many,
Yes, Vishal.
And you know, many students come to us after 2-3 years of WorkEx, and they said, okay, now they want to go for GMAT because at 720, when you have a score of 720 in GMAT, you need a 95 percentile. But similar 95 percentile in CAT does not lead to a good college as good as ISP. So that comparison when it comes into picture, and the flexibility, because if someone is preparing for CAT exam, if exam goes well, it's fine. Otherwise, they have to wait for 1 year. Unlike GMAT, where let's say we talk about only Priyanshi's case. In the first attempt, things did not went the way we expected. But that flexibility to take the exam in the next few days or months has enabled her to actually secure the seat.
If it were for the CAT, then she would have lost the whole year.
Yes. Yeah.
And that is something I'm not ready for, which is probably another reason for not taking it.
Right, right. So, Priyanshi, so there are a lot of people today in the audience who are probably preparing for their GMAT right now. So, do you have any advice for them about how they can streamline their preparation from day one?
Yeah, so I think I talked about it already, but if I just put them in pointers again, do your homework after every class. If you're not taking a class, then I think thoroughly get well-versed with the official guide first before you move ahead with the red book or the blue book. The red book you can do alongside the official guide because it has like the average level questions, but be thorough with all the concepts before you move on to higher level concepts, because if your basics are not clear and then you get questions wrong at the 700 to 800 level questions, then that'll really lead to your entire morale crashing, and you would again be demotivated to study more and get a higher score, which is why being thorough with the official guide is point number one, and doing your homework every single day, having probably a study plan that, okay, this is the amount of work that I'm supposed to complete this month, this is the amount of work that I'm supposed to complete this next month, and probably even having weekly goals with respect to the number of tests you want to take in a week and so on. So then the third point would again be taking a lot of test preps. By a lot of, I mean till the time you feel you're entirely comfortable with the testing environment. That could be, in your case, 3 tests, 4 tests, 5 tests. For me, it was definitely more than that. I think it was 15, 20 tests, which is what led to an increase in my score. So till the time you're comfortable with that environment and you're consistently scoring the score that you expect you should and that you think is a true reflection of your capabilities, till that time, continue taking practice tests and continue analyzing your practice tests. I would say that you should not jump from one test to another without putting any thought to your mistakes or without putting any thoughts to your patterns. So again, analyze each test, analyze each mistake, be thorough with the official guide, be thorough with your concepts, and complete your homework. Have plans if you can. That's completely subjective because some people work without specific timetables and plans. Some people do. I personally do not have study plans, but I've heard that those work for certain people, which is why I'm recommending. But yeah, I think these would be the major pointers. And after you're done with your basics, then you could probably move on to higher level questions, which are in the blue book provided by Jabari, or I think there are some online also. I'm not sure. I did not access a lot of GMAT Club and all of these online question banks. I did not access them, so I'm not sure about them. But yeah, I think these would be my tips, if we call them those.
So, and when you started with the applications finally, so the essays and all, did you face any trouble with writing your essays, et cetera, for the application? How much time did that take?
My essays were, so in the beginning, I had a little mental block with respect to what I should write in my essays, because the essay topic that we had, that my batch of applications had, was required a lot of personal introspection. And I would say that I am not accustomed to, you know, introspecting a lot or thinking about my experiences every now and then. And which is why that really compelled me to think about all major experiences of my life since the beginning of my life and to date. So I think I spent 1 month, 1.5 months on the essay, like not entirely on writing the essay. I think for the most part of the first month, I was only coming up with examples. So this would go on in the back of my mind. And while I'm doing anything, while I'm on my way to college or in a class, some random example would pop up from, let's say, ninth grade, and I would write it in my notes of my phone. And I would keep writing such examples, any example that I think is even remotely relevant to the topic, to the essay topic. I wrote many such examples. And I think 3 to 4 weeks before the application deadline, I started formalizing all of these examples. I put them in one document, and then I started working on them. Then I started editing them out or making the language better, making the articulation better, removing some examples that are not that relevant. But I think if it's a personal essay, major part of the essay process should be introspection. You should spend significant amount of time on that, because you will, I mean, I was genuinely surprised with the amount of experiences that I suddenly remembered, experiences that I had practically forgotten about my school life and about my childhood. So I think that is really important. And when you randomly get these examples in your mind, jot them down somewhere, because when you sit to write your essay, you probably will forget them. So have these pointers, and then finally go with these pointers and formulate an essay. Then spend a week or two, depending on your capabilities, depending on your writing skills, of course. Then spend some time on editing it. I think a lot of time has to be spent on editing also, because the word limit is 300 words, and to include 4 or 5 examples in 300 words, it's a bit of a challenge. So yeah, spend time on that, and then of course putting every example in a language that makes it interactive. I think that for an essay to be considered a decent or a good essay, it should be like any other piece of writing, it should be able to connect the reader with itself. So while the reader is reading an essay, they should feel that they're genuinely listening to the author, and they're literally in their personal life. So that is something that you should aim at. And after you're done with your final edits, I would recommend getting your opinion from getting an opinion on the essays from a few friends. One of my friends really helped me with my essay. He was very good at writing and everything, so he helped me articulate my examples better. So I would say that not all the efforts put in my essay were by my side, and my friends helped me a lot. They gave me honest opinions, told me about the sentence that could be changed to make them more interesting or to make them more impactful. So I think this should be the process: that introspect, jot down points, get them all together in one document, start editing and making it better, and then getting opinions from people who you think will give you honest and candid and unfiltered opinions.
Right. So at this point, we'll take questions. So how it would go is that, if you have a question, please raise your hand. I will give you mic access. You can unmute yourself and ask your question either to Vishal or me or Priyanshi. All right, guys?
One minute here. My laptop's battery is dying. I just have to connect the charger.
Yeah, sure. Yep. So in the meantime, those of you, if you have a question, please raise your hand. Okay, Arjun. Just give us a minute.
Hi, so am I audible?
Yes, just speak slightly louder.
Yeah, sure. So I wanted to know, like, what was your interview experience? Like, what questions were, like, did the panelists ask you? If you can throw some light on that.
Right, sure. Hi, my interview experience was like the questions they asked me were pretty generic, I would call them. So the interview began with the cliche, tell me something about yourself. So I did. And after that, they asked me, coincidentally on that day, I had a parliamentary debate at my college, which I was organizing. So I went from there to the interview because it was in the afternoon. So that also came in conversation. So that started the conversation about my involvement with the debating society and my involvement with the activity. So we discussed my major extracurricular activity, that is debating, as I said. Then they asked me why do I want to get into ISB's ILB and what is it about the program that attracts me. And I covered points that I covered here in the first part of the webinar, it gives you a certain amount of certainty, it gives you freedom to explore in these 2 years without that constant blinder of making a profile that's good for an MBA class. So these are the points that I talked about. Then they asked me about what I wanted to do after my MBA from ISB. So I told them that, and post which they one of the panelists, he posed a case study. It wasn't a case study per se, but he told me about a specific company and a specific crisis that's going on with them. And I'll be as specific as I can. He told me that there was a crisis going on with Paytm, and their investors are their investors want to back down because the company is going in huge losses. And he asked me, do you know about this? This has been really in the news these days. And I did not know about it. And I said, I don't know about it. I haven't read about it. So if you could please explain it further. So he did explain it to me further. He was sweet enough to do that. He explained the entire problem to me. And then he asked me that if you were their consultant, their financial consultant, then what would your step be, or what would your advice be? So, point is, an educated mind, because I didn't realize this, but what problem is, because I
can Vishal, can you hear Priyanshi?
No, I think there is some connection issue.
Yeah,
I thought it was from my end.
No,
so she has logged in from another account.
Right.
Priyanshi, please go ahead.
Am I visible and audible?
Yeah, visible and audible. Yes.
Okay. I'm not visible to myself. Okay. After that specific question about a company and their problem, then again they talked to me about, I think, again, my extracurricular activities, my leadership positions held in college, and then they asked me about a difficult person that I've encountered in any team that I've worked with in college or in my internships, and how my experience was with that person and how I tackled that person and got them to work with the team. So I had a few examples in my mind. I just talked about one example, one specific person that I had that was difficult in a team, and I talked about how I made them also work efficiently and contribute efficiently in the team. So that was another question. And I think that was it. I might have missed one or two minor questions because it's been a long time and I don't exactly but I think these were the major questions. And after which they asked me if they also told me that another, I think, backdrop of my interview process was that I said that I wanted to get into finance and financial consulting. So one of the panelists said that if you're aware, then ISB is not that good for finance, and a lot of people end up in jobs that are not finance related, and a very few people end up in finance related jobs because I think the recruiters that come to ISB for finance, they specifically look for people who have prior work experience. So to which I answered that during the 2 years of my deferment period, if I would focus on financial advisory or financial consulting and such jobs in order to get some prior experience so that when I go to ISB, I will have this prior experience and I will have an MBA, which is why I will be a competent candidate to get a job in the financial sector, which I think convinced them. But this was another question, and I think that's it.
Okay. So that sounds good. So Arjun, you have a couple of questions. I have given you mic access again. Can you try?
Hi, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes. But just try to speak a little louder.
Sure. I think there might be a problem with my internal microphone, but I'll try to be as loud as I can. So the first question that I have is that me personally, I do not have the best GPA in college. But I have heard from a lot of people that if you're getting an exceptional GMAT score, you can often offset that GPA that you weren't really, wasn't that good for you. So what are your opinions on that?
Whose opinion is being asked for? Is it mine?
Either of you. I mean, in your experience, how do you think that pans out?
I would say the other panelists are more experienced to answer this. I have only had one experience. They've had experience with a lot of students.
So Arjun, it is true that admissions committees, they look at your academic record and your GMAT score as one component. You know, one of them has to be good, and GMAT is going to be the more recent one. So you anyway can't go into your past and change your academic record, right? So whatever it is, you have to live with that. So I have seen students with, in my experience, students with 41% in their bachelor's degree, 49%. I mean, I particularly remember three students who literally they were so upset because they did not even qualify to take the CAT exam. So they took GMAT. They got 700 plus scores. One of them went to ISB. A couple of them went outside India. So yes, good news about ISB or other universities is that the universities that accept GMAT is that they look at GMAT and your academics as a single bucket. So if you feel that your GMAT score, your academics are not as good as you would have wanted them to be, or if you know that they are definitely not in the top, that you are not in the top 20, top 30% of your university, then try to get a high GMAT score. And by high, high is very subjective. So as high as possible is what I would say. Does that help, Arjun?
Yes, that does answer my question. So I just had another question. So in terms of taking the GMAT, I did give a GMAT a few weeks ago, and that was based on zero preparation. So I just sat down for the test, and I took about 2 to 2.5 hours to give the test. So on the base score that you get without any preparation, how much time would you recommend for a 100-point improvement, like for each 100-point jump on the test? I mean, just as a very objective thing. I mean, of course, there is this thing that, as much as you practice, you're going to get better.
Yeah.
But I think I would like to answer this question. So Arjun, 100 points improvement is very generic in nature, because if you look at GMAT score, it varies from 200 to 800. If the base score is 300, 400, 500, then this 100 points improvement is comparatively easy to get. But if someone is already sitting at a score of 650, 660, then this 100 point improvement can be challenging. But basic point is, when you have taken the first test, when we are saying this is the base score, is it right to say that without doing any sort of preparation, if we take a test, that's my base score? I don't think so. I think even if you don't take a formal coaching, but there is few sanity check, few revisions that one need to do in order to get the base score. And on an average, we have seen an improvement of 130, 140 points from the so-called diagnostic test in the first attempt test after, when students join us, until the exam, they get the final score. So this is significantly improvement considering that base score, and this can be achieved within a period of 3 to 4 months. There are multiple claims that this can be done early, but it also depends on how occupied you are at your college, at your work. If you are totally dedicated to GMAT, then definitely this time to fill this gap will reduce.
Okay.
Right.
So Arjun, you took the actual GMAT without preparation, or did you take a mock test, a GMAT prep test?
It was a GMAT prep test from their official website.
Okay. So that's not the actual test. Everybody takes prep. You know, that's fine. I thought you took the actual $200, $250 exam without
preparation. That might have been completely, that would have been a waste of money since I had zero preparation.
Right. Because when you said I took the test, why I thought, that's why I wanted to clarify. So so a lot of students do that. Actually, they take their two tests on the MBA.com website, which are completely free. So the people do tend to do that. You know, they want to kind of, you know, they take the exam. So did you take it in entirety? That means AWA, IR, the whole thing, or did you just selectively take some questions?
I took the entire test, and I like Priyanshi said, I'm not very good at sitting in one place. So I think I finished the test in about 2 hours or so, like 1 hour, 15 minutes, something like that. Because I was getting very impatient when I was answering them, because one, I didn't have like enough preparation. So I wasn't really, for lack of a better word, interested in going through the whole test. So at that time, yes, I did take the mock test.
Yeah. So Arjun, so again, Vishal, you would probably agree. Arjun didn't actually seem to have taken a mock test per se. He probably took some selective portions. 1.5 hours is not possible to take the entire exam. So in your case, if your score is lower than 600, if you got a score lower than 600, then getting a 100-point improvement which about 2 to 3 months of studies should not be that much of a challenge. What do you think, Vishal?
Absolutely with you. And on an average, Osma, we see an improvement of 120, 130 points in the score of the student. But having said that, important thing is, because in the actual exam, we do not have the flexibility of cherry picking some of these sections. So definitely we need to train ourselves to those exam conditions.
Right.
So don't, Arjun, then, take the second GMAT prep in a hurry. There are very few official full length tests available, so you should not waste them.
Yes, for sure. Thank you.
And also, Ozma, I think one point is coming to my mind. There are multiple institutes who are providing these free tests, but reliability is again a question mark there. So if, let's say, someone has taken X institute's GMAT exam, the mock exam, and the score out of 800 which is provided may not reflect the same, because many times to this Southeast Asia GMAT summit, I had a discussion with psychometricians and the product head. They said their methodology is something which is not possible to replicate. So everyone is speculating. So the best way to understand the score is to get the score on MBA.com. And as you rightly mentioned, we have in total 6 tests available. So while testing it, we should not, if I use the word for the lack of other word, we should not waste those tests.
Right. So I see a couple of questions. There's some people who today raise hands, so I'll just kind of take that on. Sneha Rao. So those of you who want to ask a question, please raise your hand. Sneha Rao. Yes, we can.
So as a part of our application process, we are supposed to get a LOR signed. So, can you please suggest from whom should we get it done? Like from someone from our college professor or someone from our internship? Like, what would be more beneficial?
So Priyanshi, who did you get yours from?
I got from a college professor who has also been my supervisor for my college's Model United Nations Conference. So I was the secretary general and she was the convener. So she was essentially my supervisor for that, and she was also my professor, and in both of her subjects I scored an O grade, so I thought she was the best person to contact.
So Sneha, to answer your question, if you have got good grades in college, then take one from your college professor. There are lots of advantage of taking a letter of recommendation for the YLP program. It helps if you take from from your college professor, because that person would have known you longer. Internship, maybe, I don't know, probably you have done for 4 weeks, 6 weeks. That's just not long enough.
Yeah.
So if you have some professors in whose courses you have scored highly, then it's always a better option to take it from them.
Okay, thank you.
Isha, you can unmute yourself and ask your question. Isha, are you there? Isha? Isha, I have given you mic access. You can unmute yourself.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Please go ahead.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, Isha, please go ahead.
Yeah. So my question was that currently I'm in first year and I would be applying for a YLP program in my next year. So I had a question that what is the right time to give GMAT? Like, what is the right time to take GMAT's coaching? Like in the third sem or when the third sem is ended, like in fourth semester, or should we wait for the round one result so that if we are selected for round two for the like GMAT score when they want in round two, so should we wait for the round one result like after March, April, maybe?
If I would answer that, I would say that you take it in your fourth semester. That's what I did. I took it, not in the fourth semester. Yeah, that is January of the year that you plan to apply for the program. So, because I think if you wait for the round one results and then start your preparations, that doesn't leave you with as much time and then you'll have to hurry up through the process. So, even if you do not get through round one, I'm sure you can use the GMAT somewhere else. And I'm sure you will have a backup option, a backup college with which you can use the GMAT score, because that's the amount of flexibility the test gives you, that you can use it for a wide range of universities. So even if you don't get through, you will be able to use the test for 5 years for a variety of universities. So I would suggest starting the preparation in January if the deadline is let's say, if the first round deadline is, let's say, in March, as the process usually is.
Right. So Chirag, you can unmute yourself. What is your question, Chirag Tukral?
Hello.
Yes, we can.
Yes. So actually, I wanted to ask that basically I started my preparation, as you said, you should basically start your preparation by January, but I started my preparation with Jamboree from February end. So I had this interpretation and misconception that I would not be able to prepare myself for GMAT in 3 months. So what do you think, how many months it will take after taking those 22 classes of 11 verbal and 11 quant, how much time I should give in for GMAT to fully prepare myself for this program?
Again, as I said, that that is subjective, and I've given you two examples of one when I was not responsible and I was not regularly studying, and one when I was regularly studying. So when I wasn't, I spent January, February, March, April, May, 5 months, and I was not attentive. I was not doing the homework, doing absolutely nothing except for going and attending the classes. So then, obviously, I could not do good at the GMAT. But then when I started intensive preparation in June, I could do it in practically 2.5 months. So these are two examples. These are very clear two examples, stating subjectivity and stating that you will finish your preparation in the duration depending on what your capacity and depending on what your dedication towards the exam is. So if you're regular with the practice, regular with the homework, and you're taking regular tests, I would say 3 months is okay, 3 months is a decent amount of time. But if you're not, then no amount of time is decent.
Vishal, would you want to put in some data? How much time do our students, on an average, how much time do they take?
Right.
The classes plus, post-class practice.
Right. So if a student is enrolled for a weekend class, and according to Chirag's comment, it appears to me that he joined for the weekend classes, then it is going to take around 2.5 months to complete the classroom sessions. And once that is done, on an average, we need 45 days. Definitely, these things are highly customizable based on your ability. But as Priyanshi also rightly mentioned, not about attending the classes, it's about doing the homework at your end. So it depends on your ability, your availability to solve those questions. In my interaction with students, I have seen bare minimum time as 41 days. There was a student who was interacting with me for 41 days. That student was totally dedicated to GMAT. Day in and day out, we were preparing for GMAT. 41 days, she was able to take the exam and do well. When I'm saying do well, it was a score of 740. But there is no end to it. So on an average, you can say 4 months is a good enough time to prepare for GMAT. Bare minimum, I have seen 41, but that's again not the lower limit. On the higher side, there is no end. Okay, so you can continue to prepare. But good thing is, in addition to our weekend classes, we also have something which is fast track batches of classes. So if let's say you are slightly having relaxed schedule at your college or at your office, right, in the internship, then definitely you can have a customized plan with your faculty where you can attend some classes in weekdays, some classes in weekends, so that you can speed up the preparation. But while doing so, please make sure that whatever assignments are given to you for that topic, you complete that. Merely attending the classes will not help. And as a ballpark figure, it's 4 months. Thank you.
So actually, Ananya has a very interesting question. So Priyanshi, you may want to, you know, address it. Her question is, where to start the preparation from? Should we directly go to a coaching center, or can you start on your own and then join coaching? So what would be, you know, your recommendation? I mean, having gone through the journey yourself.
Yeah. So I wouldn't say it's a rule of thumb, but I straight away joined the classes. I am somebody who is not very, good at following timetables or routines. So if I would start studying myself, that would not have helped me so much, which is why I straight away started with the classes. And I think that really helped me, and that really was a good decision for me, because when you take the classes, when I took the classes, I got specific direction with respect to what am I supposed to study, what are the skills that they're testing. And during the classes, like, our teacher specifically told us that, okay, if this is the type of the question, this is the concept that they're testing. So that really started the preparation process for me, with a mindset of looking at questions that way. That, okay, if this is the type of the question, then this is the concept they're testing. And this is, let's say, if a verbal question is testing parallelism, I would know straight away right after reading the question, which is what really helped me, holding the nerve of every question right from the beginning, so that I was clearer on my concepts right from the beginning, and I was able to practice and score better. So I really, it worked out for me taking classes, because it sets you on a path that is really result oriented and directed, and you don't, divert from the main concepts and from the main syllabus to, let's say, additional books that you do not necessarily have to read. So I would recommend that, and that is what I did.
But that is very subjective, Ananya. You know, a lot of students, they like go to the MBA.com website, they attempt some questions, you know, to see where they are currently at, and then they come to us. So I think there is no, as Priyanshi said, there is no rule of thumb, that there is no blanket rule that everybody has to follow the same path. So we have students who come directly to us, you know, and there are also students who just go through the official guide once on their own and then come. So it's up to you, Ananya. I think it's, if you think that you want to first take the MBA.com GMAT prep test first, see where you stand, and then come to a coaching center, that's up to you. Or if you think that you want guidance from day one, then you can do that as well. It's totally your call. It's very, very subjective.
I mean, I think it all depends on your personal capacity, whether you're able to discipline yourself to the extent of, you know, practicing every day. And that is something that I could not do, and I knew I could not do, which is why I took the classes.
Right. It's very easy for me to say, no, you should come directly to Jamboree, but that things don't work like that. You know, it's very subjective at the end of the day. So it's you know, it's your call. You know yourself better than anybody else does. So.
Yeah.
So Jyotsna, you can ask your question, or you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, Priyanshi, how was your mood while you're writing the exam? I mean, in the sense, you were spontaneous, or did you make any strategy while attempting the exam?
I wouldn't say I made a strategy per se. The only thing close to a strategy that I had was to attempt the quant section first. Because I think quant is something that we're accustomed to, and that helps us warm up for the exam and then go ahead with verbal. But that is the only strategy I think that I had. Apart from that, I didn't have any strategy. I just was sure of, I just tried to pick up from every question what they're trying to test, and then specifically focusing on that and focusing on not repeating the mistakes that I've made earlier. So I think that was everything close to a strategy that I had. And I would recommend going with the section that you're most comfortable with first. If I think the majority Indian students are comfortable with quant, which is why they take it first, so that warms them up for the test, and then they go ahead with verbal. So if you're good at verbal and you think that it's your completely comfortable and it's convenient, then you should start with that and then go ahead with quant. So that is, I think, what I followed.
Okay, that's cool. Like, how did you go with the concept that you found up? Were you skipping that questions, or did you gain good knowledge about them and move forward?
I did not skip any concepts, because I knew that I had to get as
high. I meant in the exam, when you were attempting the exam, when you found a question that was tough, then what did you do? Like the time management in the exam.
Right. So if a question was tough, if I would judge a question to be tough if I'm trying to solve it and it's been, let's say, a minute and a half, and I've not been able to come to the answer, then I would just select a random answer or something close to what I'm getting, and then I would just move ahead. This would mostly happen in quant, because verbal, I was for the most part I would have some reasoning to select the answers, but for quant there were certain questions which for which I was taking too much time and I was doing too much calculation, making a lot of silly mistakes, as we call them, in the process, and which is why I sometimes selected I would say for one or two questions randomly answers if they were taking too much time or taking more than the time that they're worth.
Okay, that's cool. Did you take any mock interviews?
Oh, yes, I did. Yeah, I had the admissions counseling from January, so I also had access to their mock interview services. So Aparna ma'am from January took two or three mock interviews with me, and I think they really helped me, because my opinion on interviews was that in interviews you're only supposed to go and have a candid, unfiltered and honest conversation, and I was completely alien to the concept of preparing for interviews, and I did not think that you had to prepare for interviews. So that really burst my bubble. I had a first mock with Aparna ma'am, and she asked me some questions that I had never reflected on and some questions I did not have answers to. I mean, at the back of my mind, I did, but I could not gather them at that moment. So that was really a reality check for me. And then I realized that, okay, interview preparation is also real, and that is also something I have to do. So then I read a few articles that also Aparna ma'am sent me, and certain that included certain strategies with respect to approaching interview questions. And then she took two or three mocks, by the end of which I was comfortable with, let's say, the generic questions that they ask about, or tell me about yourself, or leadership positions, or your teamwork skills, or some difficult person you've encountered, as I said earlier. So I think they repeat one or two questions in every interview. So getting some mocks or reading something on the internet, watching some videos for interviews would be beneficial, and was beneficial for me, because I was completely of the opposite opinion before that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right, so I think we were able to address most of the questions. We are just running short on time. So in case anybody has any question that we were not able to address, please type your number in the chat window. We will get back to you. And as mentioned earlier, if you want a demo class of GMAT or GRE, you can leave your number and you can get a sense of how we teach. So a free demo class just to see how it is different from preparing on your own maybe. And we, as Priyanshi said, we also do extensive admissions counseling, right from assessing your profile to interview training. So if you want more information about that, you can leave your number. Priyanshi, thank you very much. So any parting thoughts?
Parting thoughts. As you said, that there were some questions that we could not answer. So if there are still questions that anybody would like me to answer, you can message me on LinkedIn. My full name is Priyanshi Sharma, or you can email me. I will leave my email address here in the chat box so that you can access it. And I wish everybody all the best, whoever is planning for whatever programs and for their GMAT, for their application process. And I hope this question and answer session really helped.
Thanks, Priyanshi, you were a great panelist. You know, your answers were really, really deep and also pragmatic. So thanks for that, you know. Vishal, any parting thoughts, any advice to GMAT, aspirants?
Yeah, so my advice is, there's a question by Ananya whether we should join a coaching institute or prepare ourselves. Just think about one point, that whether you are a self-disciplined person or not. And you yourself knows that answer, okay? You need not to prove to anyone. If you believe that you can maintain discipline in your preparation, then definitely you can choose use the option of preparing yourself initially. But I think what we can provide you is the discipline in your preparation, that accountability. And you will be able to do really well if you are clear that for the next 3-4 months, your only priority is GMAT. I'm not saying like we will not do anything else, but if your priority is GMAT, this is a kind of exam where you are bound to do well over a period of time, because this exam provides you the flexibility which is not available in any Indian exam. You cannot wait for year after year to take CAT exam. But in GMAT, if you are prepared well, if in the first attempt it is not going well, you can always take the second attempt or maybe the third attempt. I'm not promoting the taking multiple attempts, but that flexibility actually helps you to gain edge over other people who are preparing for CAT. So all the best for your preparation journey. And in case you want to connect with any of us, we are just a text away. Leave your number. We are happy to connect with you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great rest of the weekend. All the best with your GMAT prep and your ISP applications, and stay in touch. Thanks, everybody. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.